This video is brought to you by CuriosityStream. If you sign up to CuriosityStream with the link in the description, you'll also get access to Nebula, a streaming site created by and for independent creators like myself. Rock and roll was in a strange place in the early 70s. A genre invented by kids fooling around in their garage had exploded to become a worldwide phenomenon. And somewhere in that explosion, rock shifted. It was no longer grimy clubs and scrappy underdogs. Rock became studio polish and sold-out stadium tours. It became extravagant displays of wealth, private jets, trashed hotel rooms, and copious amounts of expensive drugs. And as rock grew bigger than anyone had ever imagined possible, something in its core was being lost. Many of the genre's great acts died or broke up near the turn of the decade, and there was something missing in the rock and roll spirit. So some musicians set out in search of that missing piece, and they found it in the heart of New York's East Village at a music club called CBGB. Throughout the mid-70s, CBGBs became the crucible that forged a new era of rock and roll. And at the heart of that CBGB scene was one woman, a rock and roll warrior poet who celebrated the genre's past and looked towards its future, creating one of the most seminal albums in rock history along the way. Let's take a closer look. Musicians only get one chance to open their first studio album. Patti Smith made it count. 11 seconds into Horses, Smith delivered what is probably the most iconic lyric of her entire career.
Jesus died for somebody's sins, but not mine.
That line is a radical declaration of youth, rebellion, and freedom. It's Smith declaring that she's breaking free from the grip of tradition and authority. And it actually existed long before Smith had a music career at all. That line originated in a poem called Oath, which Smith had written early in her career. At that time, she was working her way through New York's poetry scene, but the seeds for her future rock stardom were already being sown. Smith struck up a close friendship with guitarist Lenny Kaye and encouraged him to play guitar alongside her poetry. That started a collaboration that would flourish a few years later when she turned her eyes to music. Smith had always been close to the music scene, and she noticed it shifting. She talked about this in an interview with Mojo. Rock and roll in 1974, at least in America, was going through a difficult transition. She went on to discuss the state of music as she saw it. I was young, but I felt our cultural voice was in jeopardy and needed an infusion of new people and ideas. I didn't feel like I was the one. I didn't consider myself a musician in any way, but I was a poet and a performer, and I did feel that I understood where we were at, what we'd been given, and where we should go. And if I could voice it, perhaps it could inspire the next generation. But poetry wasn't the right medium for Smith's goals. You couldn't well lay out the future of rock and roll if you weren't playing rock and roll. And so Smith and Kaye set out to find a band. As they were recruiting, they learned simple garage rock tunes. These were often made up of easy chord progressions that could be repeated infinitely and allowed Smith to improvise poetry on top. One such song was Gloria by Them. One grueling audition even involved having guitarists play Gloria for 40 minutes straight to see who would drop out. Through this audition process, they found Richard Saul, Ivan Kral, and later J.D. Daugherty, and by 1975, the Patti Smith group had a full lineup. They quickly became a staple at CBGB, and that's where record executive Clive Davis spotted them. He signed them to Arista Records, putting them in the studio to make one of the most explosive debut albums of all time. The first song on that album was their take on Gloria, but it had evolved from its modest roots. Oath had melded its way into the lyrics and expanded the song into an anthemic rally of youthful defiance.
People say beware, but I don't care.
The poem bristles with the sexual energy of misplaced youth. And and finally the song explodes into a cathartic climax as Smith and the band belt out Vim's sing-along chorus. The lyrics and performance of Gloria were overt challenges to perceptions of sexuality and gender. Smith told The Guardian about why she sang from this point of view. "My work does not reflect my sexual preferences, it reflects the fact that I feel total freedom as an artist. On Horses, that's why the sleeve note has that statement about being beyond gender. By that I mean that as an artist, I can take any position, any voice that I want." This breakdown of gender roles is reflected in the stunning, androgynous photo by Robert Mapplethorpe that became the cover of Horses. And some have read Redondo Beach as an exploration into queer identity as well. While Smith wrote that song after a fight with her sister, it's often interpreted as a lesbian tragedy. Part of the reason for this interpretation was the song's title. Redondo Beach was a famous queer cruising spot in the 1970s. And that song is one of many on Horses with a morbid edge. In 1975, Smith felt that the rock world was still reeling from the deaths of Jimi Hendrix, Janis Joplin, and Jim Morrison. It was a dream about Morrison that provided the inspiration for Break It Up, as Smith explained in Complete Smith. "I saw a man stretched across a marble slab, Jim Morrison. He was alive with wings that merged with the marble. Like Prometheus, he struggled, but freedom was beyond him.
I could hear the angel calling."
The last song on the album is also a tribute to a lost rock great. Elegy was written to commemorate Jimi Hendrix, one of Smith's biggest influences. Smith even met Hendrix once, a few months before his death, and the first song she ever recorded was a cover of Hey Joe, spliced together with her own poetry. This connection was strengthened by the fact that Horses was recorded in Jimi Hendrix's famous Electric Lady Studios. Smith told The Guardian about this experience. "Going into Electric Ladyland to record Hey Joe, and later Horses, I felt a real sense of duty. I was very conscious that I was getting to do something that he didn't." The final lines of Elegy are borrowed from Hendrix's 1983, A Merman Should I Turn to Be.
"Can't be with us today."
As she was lamenting the loss of dead music greats, Smith was working with a living great. Horses was produced by John Cale, a legendary musician, producer, and founding member of the Velvet Underground. However, Smith and Cale clashed throughout the entire recording process. Each found the other demanding and controlling, and they had completely different ideas of where the album would go. This tension played out as a kind of angry catharsis in the music, particularly in the 9-minute epic Birdland. Smith told Dave Marsh about the experience of making that song in 1976. "There's a lot of inspiration going on between the murderer and the victim, and he had me so nuts that I wound up doing this 9-minute cut that transcended anything I ever did before." Cale pushed the musicians to improvise as long as they could and drag the song out as far as they could. On top, Smith spouted a manic poem inspired by Peter Reich's The Book of Dreams. These themes of UFOs and aliens spoke to Smith's own sense of otherness and alienation. She explained this to The Guardian. "From very early on in my childhood, 4 or 5 years old, I felt alien to the human race. I felt very comfortable thinking I was from another planet because I felt disconnected. I was very tall and skinny, and I didn't look like anybody else." You can hear Smith's anguish as she denies her own humanity. She told NPR that she was targeting her album at outsiders like herself. "I was consciously trying to make a record that would make a certain type of person not feel alone. People who were like me, different. I wasn't targeting the whole world. I wasn't trying to make a hit record." At the end of Birdland, the band break out into the doo-wop chorus of Chubby Checker's song of the same name.
We like Birdland.
Smith and her group are once again acknowledging the greats of the past, this time the tortured bebop innovator Charlie Parker. Birdland has its own 9-minute companion on the B-side of the album, Land. The song that gave Horses its title is the climax of the album, smashing all of its themes and influences together into one wild ball of energy. In the opening, Smith draws on William Burroughs' The Wild Boys to tell a story of bullying and isolation. Then the band erupts into a take of Wilson Pickett's Land of a Thousand Dances, another staple of garage rock bands. The song paints grimy images of sex, drugs, and poetry, even name-dropping Smith's idol, Arthur Rimbaud. All throughout, the song retains a driving tension. The instruments chug along as Smith paints surreal images. Toward the end of the song, Smith brings in a line from Gloria. Then we end on a simple image, an image of sex and music and joy.
There was a man dancing around to this simple rock and roll song.
Rock and roll had forgotten its roots. It had grown so big that it forgot the sheer joy of playing for no reason other than the love of music. And Patti Smith helped fix that. Horses was a reclamation of the forces that created rock and roll in the first place. Youth, sexuality, and rebellion. Smith told Mojo that she did Horses as a bridge, a touchstone for the future. It became all that and more. Horses helped fuel the punk scene that was exploding out of New York, and it also laid the standard for what would become known as alternative rock. Artists like Nick Cave and the Bad Seeds, The Smiths, and R.E.M. all owe a lot to Patti Smith. And she inspired generations of female performers, from Shirley Manson to PJ Harvey to Alanis Morissette, and all the way to Lorde. The music world we live in today would undoubtedly be a drastically different place were it not for Patti Smith and Horses. New York is a city with an incredibly rich music history. Patti Smith and the rest of the CBGB regulars are just one chapter in the story of music in New York. Another key part of that history took place through the 50s and 60s, when jazz started to take on a new life in the city. Over that period, the photographer W. Eugene Smith had a loft in Manhattan where he would bring in a rotating roster of jazz musicians to play. Smith took tens of thousands of photos and recorded thousands of hours of tape over that period, and you can watch the best of that on CuriosityStream. The Jazz Loft, according to W. Eugene Smith, is a fantastic documentary that gives you a peek inside that New York jazz life. And that's just a start. CuriosityStream is the best place to find documentary content online, with thousands of documentaries on a whole host of topics. Not only that, if you sign up to CuriosityStream with the link in the description, you'll also get access to Nebula, where you can watch original content by creators like myself, Tearzoo, CGP Grey, and Polymatter. If you feel like giving it a shot, it's a great way to educate yourself on all kinds of topics, and it's also a great way to support creators who are looking for freedom from the constraints of YouTube. So thanks for checking it out, and if you've already signed up to Nebula, I want to give you an extra special thanks. The platform is already having incredible success, and it really means a lot to me that you guys are willing to support us like that.